friends to CNS Podcasts. In this special feature, welcome to a conversation with Ziad Abdul Samad, Executive Director of the Arab NGO Network for Development, or ANND. Ziad Abdul Samad is an important development justice voice, not just in Lebanon, but entire Arab region. Ziad was one of the key participants at the Breaking Grounds, Taking Roots, the Istanbul Principles at 7, a potentially game-changing meeting of hundreds of civil society champions from around the world, along with some government representatives, among others, which happened recently in Bangkok, Thailand. Ziad Abdul Samad was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. Without any further ado, let's listen to Ziad Abdul Samad from Arab NGO Network for Development, or ANND.
Have the Istanbul Principles been helpful in the past 7 years for developing CSO spaces so that they can effectively work as development actors?
We believe that civil society is an active actor in promoting social and economic rights and an active actor in the implementation of policy and policy making. And that's why civil society as an actor is also tending to hold the different other stakeholders and actors accountable to their commitments. You mentioned the Agenda 2030, which is a global commitment for the all the governments, international organizations, international institutions, intergovernmental, etc. So all these actors should be held accountable and committed to their, let's say, global agenda that they decided. So this is part of what civil society should be doing. So for civil society, in order to hold all these actors accountable, it should start by itself. Which means that civil society also should be accountable to their constituency, to the beneficiaries, to the people that they are representing, and mainly to the local communities and the other part of the societies. And that's why the Istanbul Principle is a very important tool and element, not only to hold the other accountables, talking about the mutual accountability, but also to start from how civil society can become a transparent and effective partner who is also accountable to the others. So that, this is kind of a contribution to this global agenda on, equal partnership, mutual accountability, transparency, etc.
What have been the challenges that we have confronted in implementing the Istanbul Principles over the last 7 years, and how to overcome them?
Great challenges and difficulties. Mm-hmm. I'm coming from a very complicated and difficult region. Yes. First, let's say that civil society is struggling for the right to exist first. I mean the right to acknowledge the right to assembly and the right to associate and to become member, but also the right of expression, the freedom of expression, and to access information. So all these elements are very important for civil society to become an effective partner and an effective actor. So the struggle is first to protect these rights. This is one. This needs a clear commitment from the governments, a clear acknowledgement from the government and the state that these are the partners, and without them and without an active participation from civil society, we will not be able to implement Agenda 2030 or to face the challenges of developmental challenges, and mainly the challenges that we are facing in the region when we are talking about the peace building, peaceful societies, we are talking about the access to justice, we are talking about the equity and facing all the challenges of inequality, exclusion, etc. So this is, a priority now for civil society, but also civil society, in order to be able to face all these challenges, should work hard on their, let's say, capacities, and they need to empower I mean themselves. So it's very important also to envision, I mean, how we can strengthen and empower civil society in order to become able to face all these challenges and to become an active partner in development and in holding all the governments and the other actors accountable, particularly when we are talking about the private sector as a partner for development. And the third dimension of challenges is, I mean, when we are talking about partnerships, we are talking also partnership at the global level. I mean, the partnership with the global and international community. And here is also another dimension of the challenges, opportunities and challenges, because these global partnerships can give opportunity to empower civil society, to make it more active, to give a big support according to the international principles and mainly the International Charter of Human Rights and Universal Declaration, etc. But also it can be a challenge because, let's say, when we are talking about equal partnership, when we are talking about the mutual accountability, these principles should apply also to the international actors and the international donors and the international community. So it's not only as beneficiaries we have to be accountable, but also, I mean, the donor community and the partners, the global partners, also should accept to be transparent and accountable. So
times, how do you envision redefinition of accountability and effectiveness of all actors in development cooperation?
When we are talking about accountability, we are not talking only about the financial. Accountability means politically accountable. I mean, and this is something very interesting, by the way. It's very important to ask, let's say, the international actors whether they are able to change, to modify, or to adapt their vision, their policies, their strategies, their priorities according to the local needs or the needs of the local actors, or they do according to the perception about the needs and the actors, etc. And this how we can hold them accountable. I mean, and this is what do we mean by equal partnership. Partnership is to be partners, equal partners. I mean, to take and to give and to understand, to exchange, and to be able and to have the braveness to be able to change your perception according to the needs of the local actors and your local partners. So this is what do we mean by accountability. It's not only about financial dimension. By the way, the financial dimension is not the most important element of the partnership. And when we are talking about the empowerment, it's not only about financial, because finance sometimes and in some cases they become limiting the ability of civil society, and they can frame civil society within certain, and in our region we can give a lot of examples where the international community, let's say, contributed to let's say distracting civil society from the right track. Iraq after 2003, for example, after decades of dictatorship, civil society, emerging civil society in Iraq faced a huge amount of international, let's say, intervention and actors, etc., which didn't help the emergence of a healthy, active civil society. And the same what we are witnessing now in many other countries. So sometimes this can become a threat if the international community is not aware of the importance of building the capacity of the local civil society, empowering them in a right direction, in a right way, to become independent, to become independent actors. So to be able to implement the mutual accountability, to become equal partners. So these are also threats that we need to take into consideration.
Okay, so how do you foresee the Istanbul principles helping overcome these threats, helping governments and CSOs eventually achieve Agenda 2030?
Listen, as I mentioned in the very beginning, Istanbul principles can become a very important tool in order to empower civil society, to provide civil society with the needed space, to provide civil society with the needed tool in order to become, let's say, equal partner and to mutually accountable, etc. This is important. In fact, let's say, some of the partners or stakeholders need some awareness for the implementation, not only awareness about the Istanbul principles, but how to implement Istanbul principles. But some of the stakeholders, they are aware of the Istanbul principles, and because they are aware, they don't implement them.
Can so you give an example?
Yes, of course. I mean, for some partners, civil society is a threat. I mean, democracy, transparency is not an easy, let's say, choice to be taken, especially by the decision makers. And some other stakeholders, like the private sector, for example, when you are talking about the interests and benefits. So in a system where you have a lot of tax avoidance and tax evasion, and you have all this illicit capital flows, etc., who can accept to be transparent? So it's a complicated, and also the when you are talking about the state, who is, and let me put it in this way, if I want to be soft to the governments in the global south, let's say the shrinking policy space, and then their inability to define priorities according to the national needs, because they are tied to certain conditions imposed by the donors or their partners, means that they will have more tension in relation with their societies and civil society. Means that they are, they tend to make the space for civil society shrinking or less. So although they are aware of the principle, Istanbul principles and Nairobi development outcome, let's say, so, but they have sometimes to violate these rules and principles for the sake of their international commitments, the other dimension of the international commitments, I mean. So in this, advocacy is not only to make them aware. In this, advocacy is to make them respect the commitments and the priority of the people's right, the priority of their, let's say, values, human values, and for the sake of human dignity, equality, etc. I'm coming from a region where we are facing a lot of difficulties, okay? And things is not only related to morals and values, it's a balance of power. So that's why when we are talking about empowering civil societies, at least to create this balance of power in order to be able to impose our values, our principles, democratic values, democratic principles, the rights-based approach. So it's not only about learning people or talking about the moral dimension and the values, etc. It's about the balance of power, and that's why we need an empowered civil society, we need independent civil society who is able to become, to impose, let's say, its role, to impose its presence, and to impose itself as an equal stakeholder and partner when it comes to implementing democratic values and developmental policies and strategies. And mainly we're talking about the Agenda 2030 and the SDGs. So civil society should be empowered to play this role.
We were listening to Ziad Abdul Samad, Executive Director of the Arab NGO Network for Development, or ANND, who was one of the key participants at the Breaking Ground, Sticking Roots, the Istanbul Principles at 7 meeting in Bangkok, Thailand. He was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. For more details, be welcome to check out CSO Partnership for Development Effectiveness, or CPDE's website at www.csopartnership.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned.